On behalf of the Professional Development Committee of the LPC, thank you for joining us for our latest in our webinar series. This webinar is on Altmetrics for Library Publishers. We have two speakers today. Andrea Michalek is the president of Plum Analytics, an EBSCO company. Plum Analytics, with the vision of bringing more modern ways of telling the stories of research to individuals and organizations that fund, perform, or publish research. Through her consulting work, she's helped dozens of startups successfully launch their products. In 2007, Andrea helped launch the Summon Web-Scale Discovery Service at Serial Solutions, where she was director of technology. In 2013, Andrea and her Plum Analytics team joined EBSCO Information Services as a wholly owned subsidiary. Andrea earned a Bachelor of Science degree in Computational Biology from Carnegie Mellon University and a Master's of Science in Computer Science from Villanova University. So her talk is 10 Altmetrics Trends to Watch If You Are a Library Publisher, and she sums that up as scholarly communications have moved from print to online, the ecosystem of tools to quantify engagement and impact have evolved as well. And I will introduce Tim after Andrea finishes. Andrea?
Perfect. Thank you. So I am going to walk through the 10 trends to watch if you're a library publisher, kind of David Letterman style here. So starting with trend number 10. So first trend I want to talk about is how the universe of metrics is expanding. So back in the 1960s, when impact factor came along, it was all about citations and then bibliometrics and things like the H index to talk about engagement and impact of scholarly publishing. And now we're in a much louder space with many more metrics out there and many more ways to use this data that present themselves to both researchers as well as readers and authors. So I wanted to define altmetrics at the beginning, where altmetrics is defined as alternative ways of measuring the use and impact of scholarship. So it combines both traditional citation counts with non-traditional measures. And different people have different definitions of altmetrics, but at Plum, this is what we use and kind of how we think of metrics. And altmetrics are encompassing of all metrics, both traditional and non-traditional. There's two main altmetrics aggregators. So here is an example of a particular journal article and altmetrics from both. The one on the left is from altmetric.com. They have a donut visualization where they put a score in the center of that donut that talks about how much attention or buzz has that particular journal article received. And then on the right is the Plum print visualization that shows engagement around five categories of metrics. And this is what we developed at Plum Analytics. So as we look at Plum around metrics that you can gather, we've gone and we've categorized them into five specific and different categories of metrics.
Andrea?
Yes, can you hear me? Yeah.
I'm sorry to interrupt you. We've had one request that you speak up just a little bit. I'm not having trouble hearing you, but if it's possible for you to
absolutely
speak a little louder.
I can always
be
louder. For sure. Okay, great. So
thank you.
Hopefully this is better. I will shout it from the rooftops if you need me to, and I'll try not to blast everyone else's eardrums out of the conference call, so I apologize to anyone wearing a headset. So the five categories of metrics are usage, captures, mentions, social media, and citations. I just want to take a half minute and describe what each of them are, because they are different. So usage is when someone is actually engaging with the work. So they're viewing it, they're clicking it, they're downloading it. If it's a book, it's a book that we count how many collections it's in. So that's usage metrics in that category. The next category are captures, where someone has gone and said, I want to come back to this later. They saved it for later. And these captures are a nice leading indicator to something that's immediate that we can tell if it's going to be likely cited or long-lived, that people are going to come back and use this research again. Mentions are where the stories are hidden. So that's if someone's written a Wikipedia article and linked over to that book or journal article, or if they've written a blog post or otherwise commented or reviewed the article. Social media is what it sounds like, the tweets, likes, plus ones. And finally, citations are as a part of these metrics. We divide those into three main categories of citations. First are citation indexes. The second are patent citations. And the third are clinical citations. So even in that category, you can see we're trying to pull apart different types of things and new ways of looking in and seeing what's happening with research. The next trend is that the pace of scholarly communication is speeding up. So as researchers have moved online, they create all of this different data exhaust about what they're doing and how they're interacting, and the technology has finally caught up to be able to measure this online activity. So we can make visible what was invisible before and measurable what was immeasurable. So that when you look at the difference here between the traditional form of scholarly measure, which was all about counting citations and building journal impact factors on top of that, and even the H index that you can look at on a particular author, and contrast that with a timeline of, so if you're looking at on the left-hand column here are the different activities that a researcher might go through while they publish a single journal article. And it used to be you needed to wait all the way until they've gotten citations from their work to really begin to measure it, whereas nowadays you can measure all along the continuum. As these different types of outputs are being produced, we can gather metrics immediately and begin to tell that story. Trend number 8 is that usage data itself is becoming increasingly important to researchers. This slide is from a study that Taylor and Francis did about open access, and it looks at the difference. They ask the question here, you know, what should the following types of article metrics will become important for assessing value in the next 10 years. And so not surprisingly, looking over 10 years, people said, yes, citations are important. So if you look at the light blue and darker blue, over 80% of people they polled said, yes, this is important. But one of the interesting pieces is that usage also, over 60% polled said, yes, this will be important. And altmetrics, as defined by them, which isn't exclusive of these two, was lower. But the fact that usage is the number two thing that people think is important to measure and quantify and talk about is, to us, a remarkable outcome of this. Trend 7 is that the standards around these metrics are gaining traction, and I'm going to talk about two different initiatives from NISO. The first is NISO has been doing a bunch of work around altmetrics and what should this new field of altmetrics be doing and building standards. One of the really interesting outputs that came from all of their work is developing a code of conduct for altmetrics providers. And so this is recent. This is probably in the last 30 days or so. And as a part of this code of conduct, they posed questions such as, you know, describing the limitations of the data. How often is it updated? How is it aggregated? And defining each and every metric. So at the link here at the bottom of the screen is where we've answered these questions. And it really helps folks looking to evaluate what are alt metrics get a definition from all the different providers of this sort of data to see what we're really talking about, and then how might you engage with it, or what other questions do you have? The second standard is something that Tim Deliyannides from Pitt is going to talk about in more detail later, but it's around what's called sushi light. I really had to hold myself back from putting an image of sushi on the slide here. But what sushi light is if you think of what counter is for journals, sushi light is for article level metrics. So our work that we've done together with the University of Pittsburgh in the PlumX platform is the first commercial use case of seeing this standard in practice. So we wanted to share usage data about what was happening, but we wanted to do it in a forward-looking, standards-compliant way, so what was happening with each journal article that they publish. So this is a really great way to do that and to kind of press these standards forward in a practical way. So we're very, very proud of the work that we did together there. Trend number six is that green open access tells more of the story behind what's happening with a published journal article. So we want to make sure that our metrics are inclusive of that. So I'm going to walk through an explanation of what I mean here. So when we start gathering metrics about, let's say, a journal article, it all starts with a seed. It starts with a place to start, like the DOI of the article or a link to the article somewhere where it's published. This seed can be any one of those places, and it doesn't truly matter, because then what happens is our technology goes and gathers up more of the seeds with the goal to tell this beautiful story, to have these seeds grow into a wonderful way to talk about the impact that that particular article had. So the seeds can be, like I mentioned, any of these sorts of things, any place where we're going to start and say, this uniquely identifies a single artifact that I want to track. And I'm saying artifact instead of article because it doesn't have to be a journal article. It could be a book or a book chapter or a piece of source code or a video or any of those types of things, just starting with one of these places. So here I'm going to start with an article that was actually also posted to University of Pittsburgh's Open Access Repository. And what we then build are metrics around this. And you can see in the middle column on the bottom all of the different places where this data is gathered from. So it's gathered from the place that we started, their institutional repository. We have data from PubMed. We have the DOI. We have data from PubMed Central. And we're looking at engagement around all of those places. So we're going to start with that URL. And from that, we can, someone once described this as the daisy chain of doom, right? Luckily, the technology does this automatically to be able to kind of start from that URL, extract out more pieces, extract out identifiers, so that in the end, just from the one place that we might begin, we can have over 20 URLs and 3 known identifiers to go and query for more information. We think of that visualization as a net. And with that net, normally, you might think, well, you want to capture where that journal article is published. But what we can do, because we've built that large crosswalk of all the different identifiers online of where there might be digital exhaust about that particular article or research output, we can go and gather a lot more to talk about the impact, the engagement, and all that is happening with that piece of work. Trend 5 is that we need to measure more than just articles. We need to measure the components of that, like the data set behind the article, and we need to measure other things that are published, like books. So books, it's worthy of saying that citation counts don't do books justice. They never have, they never will, and we need new metrics around this. It's important to things out, disciplines especially outside of STEM, and often these books are important pieces of research output. There's something that a particular researcher, it may represent their seminal work. They want metrics, and they want it from where they've published the book to be able to get those metrics for their use. So some of the book-specific metrics that we gather, the first I talked to in the beginning when I was talking about how we track usage of books. So we partner with OCLC. We look up in WorldCat how many libraries hold this book. If someone has written a Wikipedia article and referenced the book, we can track that reference as well. Online review sources like Amazon and Goodreads, we can get the actual reviews to point the author to those, as well as things like ratings. And then finally, if we're talking about ebooks and even book chapters, we can then get some of the other traditional, I say traditional, other sorts of usage data like abstract views, downloads, clicks, et cetera. So we can tell more of that if it's an ebook and share it online. There's more digital exhaust that we can mine and pool together. Trend four is that the tide is rising, and by the tide, I'm referring to the metric tide. This is a report of metrics that came out of the UK and talking about the role of these new metrics in assessment and management of research. And they, part of the Metric Tide report was talking about what does it mean to be developing responsible metrics, things that as creators and users of metrics that we should be thinking about and making sure we're putting in front of the authors who have written the work as well as those people viewing the work. We want to make sure that we adhere to this and we can honor that. And these metrics matter to the researchers. The competition for getting grant dollars is getting more and more fierce. So this slide talks a little bit about the NIH and looking at the number of applications that came in a year versus the awards. And we see that only 18% success rate, which is saying 4 out of 5 people do not get funded. And researchers need those metrics to be able to compete in that environment. Moving on to trend number three is that online users have come to expect metrics when they're looking at content online. So here is an article from Wired, and you can see in the upper left-hand corner that there's the number of times that this article has been shared on Facebook. And so as you're consuming non-scholarly data online, as we all do, we've become accustomed to having these metrics. So when we first embedded metrics into different platforms, embedded our Plumprint, we ran usability studies around those, and we found that people were, oh, this is great. This is just like those sorts of metrics I'm accustomed to seeing, but now on scholarly data. So what we embed is the Plumprint that you can hover over the Plumprint, engage with it, and gives information about the 5 categories of metrics. You can click through and then see full details about that. And this Plumprint was designed to communicate and convey information without having to give a score and calling a particular article a 0 or a 2 or a 500 or anything like that, but just to kind of pique people's interest, get them to engage, and get value out of that. So 2 examples of where this is integrated. One is, in this case, this is a search interface on top of a database, and you can see the search result list all have Plum prints there, giving that extra bit of information to the searcher to know whether they'd want to drill into that article or not. And secondly, on a particular, you know, artifact or article page, embedding the metrics there, giving more context around the discussion about that article and other things that they might be interested in learning about. Trend number two is that open metrics support open access. Looking at, by publishing in open access and as library publishers, I'm assuming many of you are publishing in open access, and one of the things that we talk about with open access publishing is giving a citation advantage. That's one of the really good reasons we reach out to researchers and try to have them publish in open access. And study after study after study shows that publishing in open access does give you this advantage, but there's nothing like showing a researcher or a potential author with their own work the advantages that they get. So showing them what's, you know, look at the data that's happening in total access versus open access, and it makes a great point. So these metrics that we can embed that give feedback in real time provide this feedback loop that helps change behavior, that helps say, hey, you know, like the speed limit sign on the side of the road, you're speeding, you need to slow down. Or the Fitbit you wear around your wrist saying you really should take that extra walk after dinner. You haven't met your goals yet. So metrics that update in real time about scholarly activities have that same sort of effect. And finally, the last trend, dare I say, that altmetrics are no longer alternative. So they have a bunch of benefits, such as how broad they are, talking about the impact of research. They're diverse. They talk about more than just the paper. They give people insight into what they're doing. The speed that they no longer are this lagging indicator that you need to wait years to see the outcome of what you've done, and they're very open. So you can see this data. It's right at people's fingertips, and they can make decisions with it. So altmetrics, you know, this image here is back in 1903, when there was a bet made of could this car be driven across the country. And at the time, there were no highways. There was only, I think, 150 miles of road across the entire country, and the journey took 63 days. So if you think back to that time, what came first, the cars or the highways? The cars came first. And with altmetrics, we're in a similar place. Is what came first, people moving online or metrics to measure that scholarly activity that's happening online? And that's, you know, that's why we are at the point now of really saying we need to be able to measure this and give some kind of insight back. So the top 10 trends are here. And with that, I'm going to stop and turn it over to Tim.
Thank you so much, Andrea. And just as a reminder to those who might have joined a little late, we're going to take questions for both presenters at the end of both speakers. Our next speaker is Tim Deliyannides. He is the Director of the Office of Scholarly Communication and Publishing and Head of Information Technology at the University Library System of the University of Pittsburgh. He is responsible for the extensive electronic publishing initiatives of the university library system there and has spent the last 15 years working with academic units and scholarly associations to promote open access to research and to help transform models of scholarly publishing. Tim oversees the publication of 40 scholarly peer-reviewed journals in addition to numerous author self-archiving repositories containing conference proceedings, electronic theses and dissertations, preprint publications, and other gray literature such as white papers and technical reports. Tim is going to speak on demonstrating journal impact with PlumX at the University of Pittsburgh, and specifically demonstrating impact for those 40 scholarly journals mentioned. And he is going to show aggregated analytic data at the journal level, as well as metrics demonstrating the impact journal.
Okay, thank you very much, Hillary. I appreciate the introduction. And thanks for asking me to share our experience with incorporating Altmetrics into our publishing program at the University of Pittsburgh. First, I want to say a few words about our history with PlumX. We have been using PlumX for several years in a number of different ways and for several different audiences at Pitt. Plum Analytics began tracking every document in our institutional repository, where we are able to see aggregated views of the output of the entire university by school, by program, even for small research groups. So I think PlumX has given us new insights, for instance, just for one example, on patterns of use for electronic theses and dissertations. We've also begun offering researcher profiles through PlumX. We began with a small pilot for about 40 researchers, each of whom have a custom profile giving a bird's eye view of their total output. Today, though, I'm not going to talk about any of these things I just mentioned. Instead, we're going to focus on Altmetrics for publishers. You may know that Pitt's University Library System partners with scholarly societies and independent editorial teams around the world to publish 40 scholarly peer-reviewed open access journals. Our journal publishing program is based on PKP's open journal systems, and we are one of a handful of major development partners for the PKP. And today I'm going to share with you how we use PlumX and OJS together to add value to our journal publishing program. I just want to recap what we see as the special value of the alternative metrics that we have through PlumX. First, we're able to put together a composite picture of many different measures. Second, we're able to track and show evidence of online behavior for the first time. And finally, Altmetrics can show impact immediately as it happens. We don't need to wait the 3 to 5 years for citations to appear before we can start to demonstrate interest and uptake in the research. So what can we expect to do with these metrics as publishers? First, we can demonstrate value to our stakeholders. And who are these stakeholders? Well, authors, to begin with. Authors are under intense pressure to demonstrate that their work has impact, and they can't afford to wait 5 years to show this impact. Journal editors face similar pressure. Most of our journals are open access. They do not charge author fees, and they're largely funded through scholarly societies or individual institutions of higher education. So editors need to demonstrate the value of their work and to show return on investment to their sponsors. And of course, funders are evaluating outcomes of research that they fund, so they're always looking for ways to measure impact. With the new information that's revealed for the first time through Altmetrics, we can gain insights into our publishing portfolios. We can see what's hot and what's not. We can get clues to reader behaviors. My hope is that eventually we'll be able to predict future impact by looking at some of the early metrics. For instance, are saved bookmarks a leading indicator for citation counts later on? I think we need more research in this area, but Altmetrics can give us the raw data that we need to answer these questions. As publishers, if we can identify the strengths and weaknesses in how our publications are being used, shared, and talked about, we may be able to use this information to improve our our marketing and promotion strategies. Editors may gain insights on how and where to attract quality submissions. Finally, I want to say, as publishers, we are competing with other journals to attract the best submissions from authors. Authors evaluate many aspects of quality when choosing a journal, besides just assessing academic quality and reputation. They also want to have confidence that the publisher is well-equipped to make their work visible in an online environment, and that the publisher has the technical infrastructure to do this. So integrating Altmetrics with the publishing platform shows technological innovation and provides a richer overall service offering to potential authors. Before I show you exactly how these metrics look in practice, I want to start with an overview of how the underlying process works. It all begins when PlumX begins tracking metrics for all of the articles that we publish. PlumX harvests new articles published in OJS using the OAI protocol for metadata harvesting. Once we set up each new journal, this becomes automatic. Then we embed the PlumX widget in the article abstract page using the OJS PlumX plugin, and I'll tell you more about that later. The Plum print displays the current metrics each time a reader views the article abstract. Finally, PlumX offers aggregated views of their analytic data with breakdowns by journal title, by volume of the journal, publication year, and other parameters. This information is not embedded in OJS. To view it, we visit the PlumX website with the proper credentials, of course. Okay, so let's jump in and see what the article metrics, article level metrics actually look like when embedded into our OJS journals. Here's an example from the journal called Pennsylvania Libraries Research and Practice. In this example, if you scroll down to the bottom of the abstract page, you will see the PlumX widget at the bottom of the abstract page. This article is about how libraries can use Wikipedia to increase the discoverability of their digital collections. It's really interesting stuff. The article hasn't been cited yet, but it has gotten some interest in social media, as you can see. Here you see Plum's five categories of metrics in a horizontal arrangement. Here's another example, this time from our International Journal of Telerehabilitation. So if you scroll down to the bottom of the abstract page, you will again see the Plum print that shows downloads, captures, some play in social media, as well as traditional citations. One really beautiful aspect of the PlumX widget is its interactivity. You can almost always drill down to see more detail. So when we click on See Details, we hop over to the Plum Analytics website for the full artifact details display. So here we can see more information than fits on the abbreviated widget display. This article happens to have been cited by seven other publications. In order for Plum to show these citation counts, the article must be indexed in one of the sources that are tracked by Plum, like PubMed Central or Scopus. And this title happens to be our only journal that's included in PubMed Central. So let's say we want to find out exactly who cited this article. We click on the PubMed, on the link for PubMed Central, and we now are looking at the article abstract view in PubMed Central. And we can follow the link to the citing articles, and we can now take a look at the seven articles that cite this work in our journal. all of the data presented by PlumX is available through other sources, and you might have other ways of finding it, but PlumX brings it all together in one place without any extra work by us, the publisher. All of these paths to new information are automatically generated by PlumX for every article. So that was a look at metrics for individual articles. Looking at these metrics rewards authors immediately with new information and insights about their own works. Article-level metrics might be of interest to readers, too, but what about the bigger picture? As I mentioned, we publish 40 scholarly journals. It's very important to us and to our publishing partners to demonstrate the impact of these publications in every way that we can. Many of our journals are small niche publications with a small readership, and many of them are quite new. So we're working very hard to build up their visibility and discoverability, but it takes time to achieve higher citation rates. So we find it extremely beneficial to have a broader range of metrics to draw on. The PlumX interface lets us look at our entire publishing portfolio as a whole. So this is an aggregate view of all of our journal publications. You can see that PlumX is analyzing all 8,292 articles across all of our journal publications. If we scroll down this screen a bit, we can see a table of these 8,000-plus articles that are organized by Plum's five categories of metrics. I have sorted the table by captures here. That's the column highlighted in pink. This view is highly interactive. It's a great way to identify your top articles for any of the metrics across all titles and all years. But PlumX can also let you view your entire portfolio by journal title. So here you can see the top 20 journals for any of the five categories of metrics. And let's take a closer look at the usage category, which is the green. We can see here that the journal in our portfolio that gets the most usage is Radical Teacher, followed by the University of Pittsburgh Law Review. If we mouse over the Law Review column, we can see more detail on the breakdown of the specific metrics in the usage category. Continuing on to the captures category, we see a different title has the highest metrics for captures. And likewise for the mentions category. So this can lead to insights into how reader behavior differs for each journal title. The more we drill down to the individual metrics, the more we're likely to learn. Here we see the title that the title Radical Teacher is the top journal for the category of social media metrics. And what are the top journals in the citations category? Well, we see that the International Journal of Telerehabilitation leads the pack here. Recall that this is our only journal included in PubMed Central. So this is a reminder to us of the importance of our efforts to have our journals included in major abstracting and indexing services. At the same time, it underscores the importance of alternative metrics. Many of our small niche journals in the humanities and social sciences are going to face an uphill battle to be included in the top indexes. It makes it more difficult to compile citation data, but we can still demonstrate their impact using other metrics. So we've been looking at summary analytics for our entire portfolio of journals, but what kind of data might a journal editor want to see? journal editors will surely want to know what impact their journal is having, what topics or authors are drawing the most interest, whether the impact of the journal is growing over time. We can filter the analytics to focus on a single journal title and then break out the view by year of publication, as I'm showing in this example from Biblios, the Journal of Librarianship and Information Science. Here we can see the metrics trending up each publication year. So this curve is very different from the traditional pattern we see for citation counts, where the curve typically tapers off over the most recent 3 years due to the nature of citation counts as a lagging indicator. An editor can also group the metrics by individual journal issue. So here we're comparing all the individual issues of the same journal, and we see that issue number 52 has the highest usage. Here is Radical Teacher once again. So we're looking at the social media metrics, this time for all the issues of Radical Teacher grouped by journal volume. The volume with the highest numbers is volume 102. So what was it about volume 102 that captured so much attention? We can hop over to a summary view of volume 102 of Radical Teacher. And we can see here that Plum is tracking the 12 articles published in that volume. A bar chart shows the relative metrics for these articles broken out by the five categories again. There are actually only four categories showing here since no citations have been clocked yet. And we can also look at the individual 12 articles in volume 102. So this happens to be a special issue devoted to teaching about climate change, which may have something to do with its high visibility on social media. I have sorted the artifacts here by social media impact. That's the column in pink. And so let's take a look at the top article that has 268 metrics on social media. And we do that just by clicking on the title where we see the full artifact display in PlumX. Here we can get the details on all of the metrics categories, and we can drill down to learn more about any one of them. If I'm an editor, I might want to know what people are actually saying about this article. And by clicking on the Tweets tab, I can display this detail, display on Twitter interactions. I can read each and every tweet if I want to. This is a way for editors to stay informed about what articles are being talked about, by whom, and what is being said. I want to close by telling you about our work on integrating PlumX with open journal systems and how you can actually set this up in OJS. We have done work in two specific areas. Both of these are the result of programming written by my colleague Clinton Graham, who is a software developer at the University of Pittsburgh. First, we created an OJS plugin to make it very easy to add Plum Analytics to any OJS journal. We've also created a second OJS plugin to improve the way OJS shares usage data with external systems like PlumX. And that's the Sushi Lite plugin. Integrating PlumX with any OJS journal is just a matter of installing the free open source plugin for PlumX into your OJS system. From there, any journal manager can configure the way the PlumX widget appears in your OJS interface. And the entire configuration is just done through the OJS web interface. A couple things to keep in mind. You first need to be a PlumX customer in order to use the PlumX widget in OJS. You also need to assign DOIs to your article. So the DOI is the hook that is needed to display PlumX metrics in OJS. Here's an example of the plugin setup that the journal manager will use to configure the display of the PlumX widget within OJS. So there are drop-downs and checkboxes that give a simple interface to set the HTML options for the standard widget. There's a lot of flexibility as to where you place the widget on the OJS abstract page. You can locate it in a number of the OJS template hooks or in a widget block on the left or the right side, and it can be manipulated just like any of the other block plugins. Finally, I want to say a few words on our work to provide a better way to share OJS usage data out to PlumX or to any other external system using the new Sushi Lite standard. Some of you may be familiar with the counter plugin for OJS. The Sushi Lite plugin that we developed is an alternative with some advantages for article level usage that uses more flexible web services to allow on-demand and just-in-time harvesting of usage data by external systems. The plugin that we contributed to the OJS community is now being used by PlumX, as Andrea mentioned, but it could also be used by any other service provider that wants to follow the emerging NISO standard. The plugin and the instructions are given on our GitHub site at the URL that I think is given later. Yes, here it is. So I hope that you've gotten some ideas about how Altmetrics might be integrated into your service offerings as a library publisher, and how this might benefit your various stakeholders. This presentation is available in dScholarship at Pitt, which is our institutional repository, at the address shown. So there you'll find the presentation and the full notes. We've also presented a little bit about our work at PlumX at Pitt in other forums. So to learn more about PlumX at Pitt, including some of the areas that I didn't cover in this presentation, please see the other links on this page. And I thank you very much. Please contact me at any time if you have follow-up questions or just would like to learn more. Thank you.
Thank you, Tim. So we have about 10 minutes for questions for Tim and Andrea. You can either submit them in the chat box through WebEx or by unmuting yourself. I'll just remind you to please mute yourself again after you ask your question. Go ahead, anyone with a question?
One question came directly through to me through the chat box. I think this is for Tim and Andrea. How are the journals and individual articles imported into Plum?
Tim, do you want to cover that, or
well,
I can?
Through OJS, Plum Analytics comes and fetches all the articles using the OAI PMH protocol. So that's open to anybody in the world that wants to harvest metadata for our content. And on a periodic basis, Plum Analytics will come and discover the new articles there. And then, Andrea, you can say what happens after that.
Yeah, and then they get, the diagram I put up of just then what happens. We look for other places that article might be published online and start the whole gathering of metrics that way. So we try to use as many standard mechanisms as we can for both how do we find out what's been newly published as well as going in and finding the metrics about them.
Other questions for Tim and Andrea? I have a couple myself, if nobody else wants to speak up. Okay. I have a question for Tim, actually. Do you know whether your editors and authors at Pitt are using Altmetrics for promotion and tenure purposes, and have you heard any feedback about that, if so?
I would say in terms of our journal publishing, I am not aware of any of the editors using the information in that way. Keep in mind that many of the editors of our journals are not at the University of Pittsburgh or at any university for that matter. A lot of them are, our journals are sponsored by scholarly societies or associations. So I would say that's a big topic for our other work with PlumX in the institutional repository and developing researcher profiles. But I can't speak of any known use cases at the University of Pittsburgh.
I'll just ask a quick follow-up question to that, if I may, about the researcher profiles, which you mentioned briefly at the beginning of your presentation. You said you started kind of piloting a project to create profiles for your researchers. Can you say a little more about that and how, is there an integration there with library publishing, or is that pretty much just contained by the repository?
That is based on the documents that are in the institutional repository, so it is of more benefit for those researchers who have put all their works in the IR, which at our university is a very small number. Now, we're moving towards implementing symplectic elements at the University of Pittsburgh, and I'd say next year at this time I'll be able to tell you more, because at that point we'll have more complete publication data for everyone in the university, which we do not have at the moment.
Right. Thank you. Other questions for Andrea and Tim? I have more questions. I can keep asking questions all afternoon, but I want to make sure people have the opportunity to get their questions in if they want. Okay, so I'll ask another question. This one is for Andrea, actually. You mentioned in your presentation, I think it was point number two maybe, but feedback loops help change behavior. And I can see how Tim kind of illustrated how that can happen on an editor level with the journal Altmetrics, that you know, if you see how certain articles or issues are more highly mentioned on social media, that can help an editor maybe gear their outreach differently for future issues. I wonder but you were speaking about researchers, not necessarily editors. And so I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about how this feedback loop of getting the Altmetrics can change researcher behavior.
Sure, and it's more on the author, you know, from the publishing perspective, more on the author side, right? Where an author wants to, if you give the author the data of seeing what's happening, and Tim spoke of it a little, right, about, well, I'll connect the dots. I'm not sure if Tim feels free to say, no, that's not the point I was making, but talking about how in the absence of citation data, giving, you know, making, trying to promote the journal to the author, giving them that data to show by publishing here what's happening with your work, who's engaging with it, who's on that platform, and bringing the metrics full circle for the author to be able to view not just one article potentially, but all of the things that they've published and be able to see what's working and what isn't working for them. And maybe get some insight as to why it isn't and where, you know, where do they publish, who do they co-author with, those sorts of questions, giving them data they can make better decisions about what they're doing with their work.
Great, thank you.
I think it gives them a way of talking about it too. That's what authors are really interested in, how they can build a story or frame a discussion. I have to say, when we first started this a couple years ago, when we talked with researchers about altmetrics, they were saying, "What is that? Why would I be interested in that?" But now the interactions are different. Authors and potential publishing partners, when we engage with them the first time, they're bringing the question, what kind of metrics can you show us if we use you as publisher, or if we put our document in the institutional repository? So,
yeah, great. Thank you. All right, we are getting close to the end of the hour, and I want to be conscious of everyone's time. So if there aren't any other questions, I'll just thank Andrea and Tim again for your very interesting presentation. And thank you to everyone for viewing the webinar. It has been recorded, and I think it will be made available on the LPC website. Is that right, Sarah?
That's correct. It'll be on our website and the LPC's YouTube channel.
Right. And I believe you should also be seeing a feedback survey soon. If you attend the webinar, it would be great if you could give us some feedback, because we are interested in seeing what you liked about these and what we might change going forward. So thank you again, everyone, for coming. And thanks to Tim and Andrea for your.
Great. Well, thank you for having us.
Thank you very much.
Bye, everyone.